name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Good evening.
Good evening.
My name is Kate Moorhead, and I am the Dean of St. John's Cathedral in Jacksonville, Florida, where Carl and Laura are soon going to be living, and Carl will be serving as a newly ordained deacon, and then, God willing, a priest. It's an honor to be here with you tonight. Carl, this evening is one of those pivotal moments in your life, a time where heaven touches earth and your life is changed forever, similar to the day of your wedding. Now, when it comes to weddings, my husband doesn't remember anything from ours. So I have a piece of advice for you about this evening. I know that you've been through a tremendous amount, both you and Laura, to get to this place. And when you think back, I'm sure it's overwhelming, the years that have passed since you first felt this call, and all of the interviewing and examinations and psychological testing and papers and seminary classes and on and on and on, all of the things that you have done and all of the things that Laura has done to bring you to this moment. It can be quite overwhelming. And there are so many details flying around in your mind right now. You're moving and you've got a new job and you've graduated from seminary. But my advice to you both tonight is to take a deep breath, empty your minds, and just be here. I want you to remember this night. This is a sacred thing, a sacrament. When I teach confirmation to youth, I love to play the trust game. Have you all ever played that, where you join hands and everyone closes their eyes, and someone at the very front leads the group all around? That's the closest image I can come to the apostolic succession. You know, Jesus touched Peter, who touched somebody, who touched somebody, who touched somebody, for hundreds and even 2,000 years up to this very bishop. And Carl, this is the closest you're going to come to Jesus touching you. And the ground will sort of shift from out from under you, and you'll be different. You just will be. St. Paul writes, "It is not ourselves that we proclaim, but Christ Jesus." As a deacon, you are first and foremost a servant of God. And I think it's significant that all priests and all bishops are first and foremost deacons. Because your first stage of ordination is simply about putting God in front of yourself. And I have really one simple thought for you as a deacon. One thing that I'd like you to keep in mind every day. I think it will help you. In order to serve God, in order to put God first, we have got to learn to listen. When you arrive at church early one Sunday morning and no one is there except for this elderly woman who's preparing the altar, listen to her. Know her life story. Why does she find it so meaningful to prepare those vessels for the altar? What has she gone through in her life? My father-in-law was a Methodist minister, and he used to say that you can preach terribly and make all the mistakes in the liturgy and even bomb your vestry meetings, but if you show up at the hospital and you really listen and love people, they'll forgive all the rest of it. Just listen to God and listen to others. Pray every day. And not just with words, but listening. It takes enormous courage to listen. I think some of us are just too scared to do that. Listening means being open to the possibility that God will do something different, that God may ask you to do something you don't want to do. Whenever the angels appeared, the first thing they said was, "Don't be afraid," right? So listening, being in the presence of angels, means being willing to be afraid, being willing to not know what is happening next. Because when you're a deacon and you put God first, you give up control, and that's scary. My father-in-law was a Methodist minister in Memphis, Tennessee. He was a campus minister at a university. And he was there the night that Dr. Martin Luther King was shot. My father-in-law had already made it clear that he listened to God and he knew there was this great sin of racism, and he had already spoken out publicly and his family had had bomb threats. But the morning after Dr. King was shot and he was praying, he thought, "I've got to go. I've got to get out of here." He went to downtown Memphis where he gathered with Episcopal priests and Presbyterians and all kinds of people. The dean of the Episcopal Cathedral in downtown Memphis took the cross from off the altar and held it up in front of him, and they marched down Poplar Avenue, which is the main drag in the city of Memphis. And everybody was screaming and hurling things at them. The city was just erupting. But my father-in-law said that there was one particular woman that he remembers vividly. She was sitting in a rocking chair on her front porch, watching and shaking her head as everyone walked by. And finally, she got so fed up with this march that she stood up and she waved her finger and she said, at the top of her lungs, "You get that cross back in the church where it belongs." Listening is scary because God may tell you to take the cross right out of the church and into the streets. I don't know. I think we're in a time of incredible change. A time of the Holy Spirit. And this diocese, God bless you all. You have been through so much. You have had so much courage and tenacity. Throughout history, during times of change, when the Holy Spirit was moving, people were scared. I think even 400 years before the birth of Christ, when Socrates was used to just talking and someone proposed writing down his thoughts, he thought that was a terrible idea. "You're going to capture my thoughts on paper," he said. "That's scary. I don't want to do it." "You can't capture a thought and put it down," he said. But thank God his student Plato was brave enough to do it, so we can still reflect on his words today. Or think back to when Gutenberg invented the printing presses in 1450. William Stafford said it was a terrible idea. He said, "I'll put my idea in that book, and when I shut it, my mind is gone." People were terrified of these things called books, that they were going to steal knowledge and condense it somehow. We live in a time of such great change, Carl, that I think you better just do something to scare yourself every day. You're going to have to be innovative and creative. You're going to have to come up with great ideas and not be afraid to test them. When J.K. Rowling gave the commencement address at Harvard in 2008, she looked out over all those smart kids and she said, "I know one thing about you guys, because you're graduating from Harvard, you haven't failed enough." And then she talked about how we learn the most from failure. There's sort of this cutting edge place where God wants you to be, where you're about to fall flat on your face and you're city urban core where we're surrounded by the homeless, where we're challenged every day to think of new ways to reach people, I'm going to be looking to you for new ideas and inspiration, and it's going to be a joy to be with you. This is a holy moment, sacrament, so breathe and keep awake, as Jesus said. Listen. It is a good evening.